although it wouldn't surprise anyone that I was drinking coffee. For my entire life, I've been fascinated with the Dead Sea Scrolls. I voraciously read everything I could about them. I studied them online. I checked books out of the library. I watched documentaries about them. They fascinate me. I wanted to see the scrolls desperately. This has been a bucket list item of mine for as long as I can remember. But alas, when they were in Chicago, and I was a college student in Nebraska, I was also a poor college student, and I couldn't make it up to Chicago to see them. But last year, the scrolls were in Salt Lake City, and I finally got to experience the Dead Sea Scrolls. I was in awe. I roamed around the Leonardo Museum, swinging from one emotional high of giddy and almost just so excited, to somber and in tears at the magnitude of the artifacts that were in front of me. It was so amazing. The reading today of the centurion reminded me so clearly of entering a small room that was off to the side of this great room where the scrolls were displayed. And in that room, there was a display of Roman soldier artifacts. The centurions, there were sandals, the breastplate, the helmet. There were remnants of the uniform skirt. And I remember the wave of emotion that ran through me at that time. Were these the artifacts of the Roman soldiers that took Christ to be crucified? Were these the artifacts of just regular soldiers who were stationed in the Holy Land? Who were the people who really wore those? What were they thinking? Who did they belong to? Did they have children? Did they have wives? What kind of people were they? What did they think? We've all seen some movie or rendition of the time of Jesus, be it Jesus Christ Superstar, or the Bible, or one of the many documentaries. In none of them do I recall the centurions and the Roman soldiers being portrayed as anything other than oppressors, oppressors of the Jewish people. But today, we hear the story in Luke of a faithful, compassionate centurion, one who clearly saw his role in leading troops of soldiers, but also felt great compassion and deep caring for a sick and dying slave and for the people in his community. They loved him. They cared about him, and he cared about them. He built them a synagogue. This man, this Roman soldier, is described as a humble man, a man who felt he was not worthy of Jesus being in his home. He was a man that had such great faith in Christ, so much faith, he believed that Jesus didn't need to touch or see his slave to heal him, but merely speak for his slave to be healed. And Jesus was awed by that faith. Edward Marquette says, "The centurion was a good man with a gentle heart and a deep faith in Christ. You would expect him to have feelings of compassion for his own son or daughter, wouldn't you? You would expect that if his son or daughter were to be near death, you would expect him to have feelings of compassion for his own child. If it were his mother or his father who were dying, or his wife, if it were one of his own children dying, of course you would expect him to have feelings of compassion. But he had feelings of compassion, not merely for his own children and his own family, but for this servant, his slave, a piece of personal property. You see, the centurion was a good man with a good heart. He was a gentle, kind, loving man, not fitting our stereotype of a centurion at all. In the reading today, we hear that the centurion loves people, that he loves us. The Jews said he told Jesus, he loves us. He built us a place to worship. What else does that tell us of this good man? Think about this. Here's this Roman soldier in a very faraway land in the role of an oppressor, but he loves them and builds them a place to worship. That has weight. That's pretty heavy. This man, this Roman soldier, wasn't a man of hatred or discrimination or prejudice. This was a man of deep commitment to fairness and to being just. Might those artifacts that I saw in Salt Lake City of the Roman soldier at the museum, might they have been from this centurion in this story? There's a parallel to the slogan of our church. Whoever you are, wherever you are in life's journey, you are welcome here. In our faith, those aren't just mere words. It's not just a mere slogan that we toss off. We live those words. We bring life to them. And this church, this community brings life to them. Earlier this month, I had a conversation with someone about our church. And this person said to me, you know, you say that I'll be accepted and welcome in your church. But I don't really know if I believe in God. And I don't think that I'll go over well with your minister. I think the people that go to your church will see right through that. I don't think I'll really be welcome. And I said, you'll be welcome. We have people in our church that come on a very regular basis, if not every Sunday, who are agnostics. We have people who come to our church who are Wiccans. We have Jews, we have Christians. We have people with lots and lots and overabundance of faith. And we have people who believe they have no faith. There's no test when you walk through those front doors that says, what do you believe to see if you can come in to the sanctuary? Whoever you are, wherever you are on life's journey, you're welcome at my church. The question is not, will we accept you where you are? But really the question is, will you give us the chance to accept you where you are? That's an interesting intersection with the centurion. In the story of the centurion, he not only welcomes the faith covenant with the Jews in their lives and in their community, even though it is different from his, far, far different from his, but also nurtured and participated in a meaningful way in that community. And the Jews valued that relationship, evidenced by them going to Jesus and making a heartfelt, strong case for Jesus to heal the centurion's sick slave. That relationship between the Jews and the centurion could have only happened by the Jews giving the centurion that chance to accept him where he was. As I pondered the story of the centurion and the great faith he displayed, the parallel that Brenda's faith and me doing this reflection today demonstrated her faith in me, and my agreeing to just say, sure, I'll do it in the blink of an eye without consideration, demonstrated my faith in her to give me a topic that I could reflect on well today. That's not lost on me, and it shouldn't be lost on anyone. You know, Luke is telling us in this story that the greatest act of faith is not done alone. The centurion loved the Jews loved the centurion. They shared together in their faith in Christ. They were faith partners. They were partners in their community. They shared a deep faithfulness in one another. Tuesday, many people gathered to celebrate and honor Chuck Holmgren. He's a great faith partner for many of us in this congregation and many more outside this congregation. Story after story was told on Tuesday of how deeply Chuck has impacted so many lives by being a faith partner and how valued he is to so many people because he is in spirit with them. But if you listened carefully on Tuesday, you heard something else. You heard Chuck telling everyone how dependent he is on us to be his faith partner and in spirit with him too. So this is a two-way street. It's a well-traveled two-way street with many intersections and opportunities for great acts of faith and partnering. What are these great acts of faith, though? How do we have and behave as faith partners with one another? A few Sundays ago, the congregation answered the question, when was the time you really felt the Spirit? And there were answers that ranged throughout the congregation from the joy of hearing the congregation sing a specific song, to a particular sermon, to a moment of solitude in the sanctuary. But each time someone described feeling that Spirit, there were two other pieces to that story, the community and other people. Consider this for a moment. Maybe the greatest act of faith and being a faith partner to anyone, everyone, is just your presence. What if it's just that simple? Just be here in this space and time with others. What if it's that easy? I recently had a conversation with someone in our congregation who was a regular member that I didn't interact with much when I started coming to this church. I said hi, I acknowledged her during the passing of the peace. She did the same with me. But then one Sunday I realized she wasn't coming to church anymore. And I felt like there was something off about coming to church on Sundays. There was a space, there was an energy that was missing. There was a void. I missed it, even though I couldn't have told you her last name at the time. When she started coming back to church, I felt settled again. That space that only she could fill, because it was her, it was her spirit, her faith partnership with me, was filled again. That's true for every one of us, every single one of us. Maybe if you have missed a Sunday or two, you have heard Brenda say something like this, I've missed you. It's not the same when you're not here. I've certainly gotten those comments from Brenda, because there are weeks where I'm gone for a couple of weeks at a time. But now I see that's not a guilt trip. It is simply a spiritual reality. Each of us, whether we know much about each other or not, whether we only see each other on Sunday mornings, or often throughout the week, we each fill a spiritual, faithful space in this community that is unique to us individually. It's not warm bodies and seats. It's not how many people are here and the number that goes on the attendance sheet. It's the spirit and faithful participation in our congregation and each other that makes us a faith partner. Lauren Winter says in The Hardest Question, Jesus and the centurion are usually glossed as the key figures in this story. But maybe the communities of translators, those who translate the centurion's needs and desires, those who speak of his character and his faith, are equally the heroes of this story. They prompt me to think about all the many ways that the threads that connect me to Jesus are often woven by friends. It is not just me and Jesus. It's me and Jesus and this community that helps me stay connected to him. She goes on to say, yes, this is a story of great faith, but it is also a story of great faith that takes its shape when the believer's community connects the believer to the Lord. Even a man of such deep, surprising faith as the centurion relied on his community to help enact that faith. Something similar probably goes for the rest of us. I look out today, and I see the faces, and I'm awestruck by the power and faith. faithfulness of what I see. And I keenly feel the absences of those who are not here or not able to be here for whatever reason. Go back to that consideration. What if it's just as simple as being here? What if that simple act of faith, of being in the same space at the same time with these people, is the greatest act of faith? Consider the people you don't even know that count on that simple act of faith of your being in their space with them. Consider the impact on the community of what we impede when we don't show up. Consider how we infuse the work of the Spirit by showing up. What if the person two rows behind you that really only ever sees the back of your head, what if that person gains great spiritual peace out of your presence here? What if your handshake during the passing of the peace, your physical touch, is something that someone finds healing to their spirit and their soul? What if the child that smiles at you when they see you, what if that is the joy that they remember about coming to church as a child that they pass on to their children? Just think about that for a moment. When I told that member a few weeks ago the story of the way she laughed in my spirit when she wasn't coming to church, she had no idea. None. And she was shocked. How often do we pass over the comment, "I missed you at church on Sunday"? Blithely and with a casual, "I missed you too. I do it too. But stop and think. When you say that to someone, when I say that to someone, I mean something. I missed them. You mean that. You missed them. You missed something they bring just by being with you in this space and time, and you missed that being. So when someone says to you, "I missed you on Sunday," they mean it too. I know it's easy to get into the habit of not coming to church on Sunday mornings. We can all come up with a bunch of reasons to skip church. I'm tired, I want to sleep in, I've got to mow the lawn, going out to breakfast with friends sounds like a lot more fun, I have work to do, I want to go on a hike, there's this cool bike tour through the monument. There's all these reasons. There are also some real barriers to overcome for some. We have health issues, transportation, access to transportation, physical comfort and pain. Sometimes sitting in these hard pews is hard on people, right? Anxiety and psychological challenges that are barriers for people participating with us in this space. Surely the Jews and the centurion experienced challenges. They were from different cultures and from such different backgrounds with wildly different priorities. They had to have had challenges to overcome and to maintain their faith partnership, to simply be in the same space at the same time with one another. We know, each of us, that it can be a challenge to faithfully participate in the spirit and life of others, and the spirit and life of this church sometimes. And as a community, we may have to do some more blasting away at barriers to make being here and participating more accessible for people with challenges. Some of us may have some Sunday morning habits to change by simply showing up, being available, and being present. That is a deeply spiritual act of participation with the spirit and the life of this community and this congregation that makes a difference.